This week's episode of our show is sponsored by the Deck of Many's Animated Spells Kickstarter. They've just launched their latest campaign featuring reference cards fully animated for the highest level spells in the game, a deck of animated tarot cards, and much, much more. To give you an idea of what's in store for this campaign, take a look at some of these cards from their first Kickstarter campaign, including the exclusive Meteor Swarm card.
If you've watched any of our videos, you know it can be difficult to get the rules for spells and spellcasting right in the heat of battle.
The Deck of Many's durable cards are perfect for staying on top of the rules at the table, and they're fully compatible with 5th edition.
Not only are they amazingly useful, the gorgeous animations help visualize the mystical energy swirling around as you cast your spells.
Visit animatedspells.com or follow the links in the description below to find the campaign on Kickstarter.
And now, onto this week's episode.
Greetings, my name is Monty Martin.
And I'm Kelly McLaughlin.
And we are the Dungeon Dudes. Welcome to our channel where we cover everything Dungeons & Dragons, including advice for players and guides for Dungeon Masters.
We upload new videos every Thursday, so please subscribe to our channel so that you never miss an episode.
Spells fill up almost a third of the player's handbook. There are hundreds of them in the game of Dungeons & Dragons 5th edition, and it is very difficult to remember all the nuances and complex rules behind every single individual spell.
With so many spells, this also means that there's a lot of different ways that these spells might work, and a lot of room for error within the way that these spells are described. A lot of players might misinterpret the way that these spells are written, or the way that they're meant to work at the table. So today we're going to talk about 10 commonly mistaken spells in Dungeons & Dragons.
Now, we're just going to go through these spells in alphabetical order, but we tried to choose spells that are emblematic of common mistakes that are applied across several different spells as well. So we're both going to zero in on ones that people get wrong a lot, as well as zero in on a few spells that really represent a trend that people get wrong time and time again when interpreting the rules for spells at their table.
There's a lot to discuss, so let's get rolling.
So the first spell that we're going to be looking at today is Create or Destroy Water, a first level transmutation spell available to clerics and druids. This is a rather innocuous looking spell until you get a crafty player that decides that they want to target a creature with the spell to destroy all the water in their body, or create water directly inside their lungs. What do you do when a player wants to do this?
The rule of thumb here is that if a spell doesn't explicitly say that it deals damage, then it shouldn't be allowed to deal damage. A lot of people try to use real-world logic to try to come up with creative ways to use their spells. If we use logic, we can say that a human body is 70% water, and therefore I should be able to destroy the water within the human body. But when we're dealing with magic, we're not really looking at the logistics of real-world issues. We're looking at magic spells. So when you read the description of the magic spell, you can only really do what is described in the description. By allowing somebody to use a spell that doesn't make attacks to cause damage, you're actually increasing the power of that spell and giving options to the players that are going to make it harder to run difficult challenges for them at the table.
We operate on the rule that spells explicitly describe their functions and how they are used in the game. They themselves are exceptions to the rules, so making exceptions for spells can set you up for real game balance problems later on. However, if you do want to embrace player creativity instead of just shutting them down, a really good rule of thumb is that if a player wants to use a spell to deal damage that doesn't describe it, simply rule that the spell requires either an attack roll or a saving throw, and it deals about 1d8 points of damage per spell level. Or maybe if it's really creative and really smart and very difficult to replicate, 2d6 points of damage per spell level.
Another option you have here is to look at spells that are close to the same level as the spell that the player is trying to cast. If they are being really creative with the idea and they have come up with a way that you as a DM decide, well, that makes sense that it would do damage, look at other spells close to the same level to determine how much damage you think that this spell might do. A great example would be somebody deciding to use Dispel Magic on a living spell. I mean, this makes sense. Using Dispel Magic to take on a magical spell just makes sense that it would do something. So if we were to look at something like the Blight spell as an option, we could use the same amount of damage and apply that here. What this does is it gives the player the satisfaction of thinking of something creative that does make sense, but you as a DM have a template that you can already lean on to determine what is fair and what makes sense in this moment.
Players often also try to get creative with spells such as Mage Hand, and try to find ways to make the Mage Hand cause chaos or distractions, like slapping creatures, tying their shoelaces together, or poking them in the eyes. In a lot of cases, I would consider these attacks, which the Mage Hand can't do, but again, if you do want to embrace this creativity, look at what other cantrips and other actions can be performed at will, add an ability check or a saving throw or an attack roll of some kind, and you're probably going to be okay with that improvisation. Just because a player came up with a really creative application for a spell that isn't in the rules doesn't necessarily mean that success should be automatic and it should create instant death or blindness or stunning or other effects. You can always put it down to the dice, set a DC, give them a saving throw or put in an attack roll, and have it roll some damage instead of it just immediately killing somebody.
For any dungeon masters out there who might allow this sort of creativity at the game, another big rule of thumb is to make sure that it's not something that can be recreated every single combat. If they use Mage Hand to do damage in a way that they could recreate every single combat encounter, that's different than if you see an opportunity and the player recognizes an opportunity where they can use the spell in an interesting way, but it only applies to the surroundings in this combat encounter, perhaps using the environment or something nearby that they can use to manipulate the way the spell works. If it's something that only works here, now, in this combat encounter, and they won't be able to recreate it next time, that is a great opportunity to let their imaginations flourish and really encourage that sort of creative play at your table.
The next spell that we're going to be looking at today is an iconic spell. It's a second level evocation spell available to sorcerers, warlocks, and wizards, and that is the Darkness spell. A spell that creates magical darkness that really works more like an inky blot of utter blackness than any sort of natural darkness.
The Darkness spell creates an area of magical darkness that you cannot see through, even if you have dark vision. So for those of you thinking that you can use the Darkness spell to create an area that you can hide inside and then fight all of the enemies with advantage, there's only very, very specific classes and features that will allow you to do that sort of thing. Mainly the warlock, who has an invocation to allow this, or the shadow sorcerer, who has an option to cast darkness and use sorcery points so that they can see inside of it. But otherwise, you're stuck in that darkness just like everybody else.
I've even seen some players that think that because they got the Darkness spell due to a racial feature like tieflings or dark elves, or because they cast the Darkness spell themselves, they're somehow immune or exempt to the effect of the Darkness spell and can see through it, but they can't. In order to see through an area of magical darkness, you need a special class feature. These are available to some warlocks and shadow sorcerers, as well as most devils in the monster manual. Creatures with true sight and blind sight can also navigate through an area of darkness as well.
The next spell we are looking at today is Dispel Magic, a third level abjuration spell available to almost every spellcasting class in the game. The rules for this spell are relatively simple, but can be misconstrued. What it boils down to is that this spell, Dispel Magic, can only be used to undo effects created by a spell that has been cast, not magical abilities.
Dispel Magic is a great solution for ending pesky spells cast in combat, but you can't use the spell to force a druid out of wild shape, or shut down a paladin's aura of protection, or in fact, you can't even use it to end the effects of a beholder's eye ray that might be persistent. These magical effects can't be dispelled by Dispel Magic because they're not spells.
It very simply breaks down like this. There are abilities and there are spells. Just because an ability might seem magical or even use a spell slot does not make it a spell. Dispel Magic only works against spells that are cast from the list of spells available in Dungeons & Dragons.
The next spell that we're looking at today is Fireball, a third level evocation spell available to sorcerers and warlocks, as well as artillerists, artificers, Pact of the Fiend Warlocks, and Light Domain Clerics. This is one of my favorite spells in the game, but it's also subject to a lot of misconceptions because the spell has changed a lot over the years and over editions of Dungeons & Dragons. I still see players that were familiar with prior editions of Dungeons & Dragons that think that Fireball in 5th edition causes the deadly blowback effect, where if you cast the Fireball spell in a constrained space, such as a hallway, it expands backwards and potentially hits you and your party members, even though you're trying to fireball the kobolds on the other side of the hallway.
This small misconception has led to a lot of unnecessary total party kills, and it just doesn't need to happen. In 5th edition rules, there is the radius of the fireball effect, and it doesn't go beyond that. So you don't need to be as worried about casting fireball in a closed-in space for fear that you're going to shoot the fire back at you like a gun through a barrel in a hallway.
Yeah, the fireball spell is always constrained to a 20-foot radius, and if it can't cover things in that radius because it's got to go through a wall, it will spread around a corner, but it won't distort or change its shape just because it can't fill the full extent of its 20-foot radius. One thing it will do, though, is set inanimate objects and flammable things on fire, so if you are casting Fireball in an environment where there are things that will catch, you might be in for a little bit of a situation still.
The next spell we're looking at is Green Flame Blade. This is an evocation cantrip available to sorcerers, wizards, and warlocks. Although it should be noted that the rules that we're talking about can also be applied to some spells like Booming Blade.
These spells were introduced in the Sword Coast Adventures Guide, and they're cool battle mage or fighter mage sort of spells that allow you to make an attack as part of casting the spell. The main point of confusion that happens with these spells is that even though you get to make an attack when you cast Green Flame Blade, you are not taking the attack action on your turn. And therefore, other effects such as extra attack or the bonus action attack from, say, Polearm Master or Dual Wielding don't get triggered, because these effects like extra attack and Dual Wielding require you to take the attack action on your turn to happen.
So when looking at these types of spells, you have to make the choice. Do you want to cast the spell, making one attack along with the spell, or would you like to make multiple attacks using the attack action and your other abilities? These are the choices that you have when we look at spells like this.
Next up on our commonly mistaken spells is Hex, a first level enchantment spell available exclusively to warlocks, but often picked up through magical secrets or other means because it is such a fantastic little spell, but it does have a few common mistakes people make when using it.
The main reason why people love Hex so much is that it allows you to add extra damage to your melee or spell attacks. However, it should be noted that this only works if you are making an attack roll. If you cast a spell that requires a saving throw, you do not get to add the Hex damage to the damage rolled for that spell's effect.
So this means that the extra damage from Hex applies to every beam of the Eldritch Blast that you hit the target with, because you're hitting it with multiple attacks. Every attack with extra attack. But it doesn't happen, for instance, if the creature walks into the area of your Hunger of Hadar spell, or if you hit it with a fireball, or you've created some sort of damaging area of effect or other AoE spell that requires the target to make a saving throw or doesn't even allow it to make its saving throw. You have to hit the target with an attack to cause the extra damage.
Now, the other part of Hex is that when you cast Hex on an enemy target, you get to choose one of their ability scores, and they have disadvantage on checks made with that ability score. The misconception here is that a lot of people apply this to things like attack rolls or saving throws, but that's not the case. This only applies to the ability checks and skills related to that ability check that they are rolling at the table. It doesn't apply to attack rolls or saving throws.
A lot of players try to use Hex as a debuff to make their spells easier to land, but this doesn't work because your spells use saving throws, not ability checks. One thing that you can do with this spell, though, is give a creature disadvantage on their strength ability checks and have one of your allies try to grapple or restrain them, which they will now have disadvantage as your fighter tries to barrel down on them and hold them to the ground.
The next thing we're looking at is actually three spells. These three spells have a lot in common, but some subtle differences that even Monty and myself have gotten wrong on multiple occasions. And that is Misty Step, Dimension Door, and Thunder Step.
All three of these spells are popular conjuration spells that allow you to teleport a certain distance. The problems that people run into with these spells is confusing how far you can teleport with these spells. Do you need line of sight to your destination? And can you bring other creatures along with you when you use these spells? So let's clear up which is which in the cases of these spells.
In the case of Misty Step or Thunder Step, these require line of sight to your destination. You need to be able to see where you're going, point to it, and say, I'm going to teleport over there. You need that line of sight in order to get there. If it's behind a door or past a wall, sorry, but you can't use Misty Step or Thunder Step.
On the other hand, with Dimension Door, you don't. You can specify a general direction, such as 500 feet straight up or 30 feet straight forward. And even if you can't see it, you still can teleport there.
When you're taking a step, you want to look where you're going. But when you're using a door, you don't always know what's on the other side. This is my easy way of remembering which one of these requires line of sight and which ones don't. Now, when we move on to the other part of these teleportation spells, some of them allow you to bring somebody with you. In this case, if we're looking at Thunder Step or Dimension Door, you can bring somebody with you when you teleport. However, Misty Step will not allow you to do that. That is for you and you alone. It should also be noted that the ones that do allow you to bring somebody with you, the creature that you're bringing cannot be a size larger than you. So unfortunately, if you're a gnome, you may not be able to bring many of the party members with you. Or, for any of you out there who think teleporting around with your horse is a good idea, you might not be able to do that either.
The last mistake that's very easy to make because people get these spells confused is that Misty Step is cast as a bonus action, whereas both Thunder Step and Dimension Door require one action to cast. Don't get your wires crossed with these ones because it makes a pretty big difference.
The next spell we're looking at today is Moonbeam, which is a second level evocation spell available for druids and some paladins. There's a few nuances of Moonbeam that can get a little bit confusing, and the same confusion applies to some other spells like Web, Cloudkill, or Spirit Guardians.
The main point of confusion with Moonbeam and spells such as Spirit Guardians and even Cloudkill, and even to another extent Web, is that these spells create an area that causes damage or an effect to creatures when they enter those areas. But the question is, when does the effect happen? And the answer is, it's not when you first create the spell. When you create Moonbeam or Spirit Guardians or Cloudkill or Web, the creatures in the area of those spells actually aren't affected by them until they start their turn in the area. Just because the spell's effect has enveloped them doesn't mean that they take damage or have to make a saving throw quite yet.
If you use your action on your turn to move Moonbeam over top of an enemy, this doesn't actually trigger its effects. It doesn't count as the enemy entering its space for the first time. Instead, since you moved it over, you have to wait until the enemy turn for them to make a save and see if they take the damage from Moonbeam.
On the flip side, if you use a spell like Thunder Wave or Telekinesis or Repelling Blast with Eldritch Blast to knock a creature that is outside the area of Cloudkill or Spirit Guardians or Moonbeam into the area, then they have entered the area of the spell and they do need to make a saving throw immediately or take damage.
This is actually a great opportunity to implement a lot of teamwork. If you have other party members who are great at shoving enemies or grappling them and forcing them into a position, or if you have a warlock with something like Repelling Blast, you can actually use teamwork to drop Moonbeam into an area and have the rest of your party just throwing enemies into that area of effect. This is a great way to inspire teamwork amongst the party and use multiple abilities to deal more damage on the battlefield. So if you move the spell's area of effect, that doesn't count as the enemy entering the space. But if you force an enemy into the space, that does.
If you have any questions about how this actually works, we recommend that you consult page 16 of the Sage Advice Compendium before you post anything in the comments about this, because we double-checked that rules resource to make sure that we had this right before we talked about this in our video.
The next spell we're looking at is actually one of Monty and my favorite spells in the entire game. But there's a few things that can be misconstrued with this spell, and that is Polymorph. This is a 4th level transmutation spell available for bards, druids, sorcerers, wizards, and trickery domain clerics.
This spell is also available to warlocks through an invocation. Polymorph is a brutally complex spell. We could talk for an entire episode about all the mistakes people make when they use this spell, but we've seen one particular mistake that keeps coming up time and time again, and it pertains to how you determine the maximum challenge rating of the creature that you can turn another creature into.
The challenge rating that you can turn a creature into is not determined by the caster, but by the target. We see this come up all the time, specifically in the example of pixies polymorphing player characters into, let's say, a T-Rex. And we see so many people say, well, pixies can't do that. They're only a quarter challenge rating. But it's not determined by the pixies. It's determined by the character or subject of the spell.
When you cast polymorph on a creature, the maximum challenge rating that that creature can become when you polymorph them is based on their character level or their challenge rating, depending on which they have. Player characters don't have challenge ratings, so an 8th level player character can transform into a beast of challenge rating 8 or less, and a monster that is challenge rating 2 can be transformed into any beast of challenge rating 2 or less. It's not based on the creature's hit dice, it's not based on the level of the spellcaster, it is based on the challenge rating or level of the target, what they can turn into.
The last spell we're going to look at today is the Suggestion spell, which is a 2nd level enchantment spell available for bards, sorcerers, warlocks, wizards, and knowledge domain clerics. The Suggestion spell allows you to influence a character by suggesting a course of action for them to take. The main mistake that is made here is that the Suggestion spell requires a verbal component. And this verbal component is actually separate than the string of words that you're putting together as the suggestion. So if you are trying to stealthily cast Suggestion during a social interaction without anybody noticing, that may not work the way you think it will.
In my campaigns, I generally tell my players that the verbal and somatic and material manipulations that go into casting a spell are very recognizable. When you move your hands about to make the somatic components, arcane runes appear in the air. When you speak a verbal spell component, your voice takes on a mystical cadence, and you have to intonate magical words that even if other creatures don't know what spell it is you're casting, it is very obvious that you are casting a spell.
The simple way to think of this is that if you are allowing verbal and material and somatic components to not have an effect on the social situations and have people not notice them going on, you're actually taking away from the core purpose of something like the sorcerer's metamagic for subtle spell. Having this ability makes the sorcerer able to cast these spells without being noticed. So that should mean that in all other instances, these components of casting a spell are noticeable.
I find that in general, spellcasting is so powerful and so potent that when you also allow spellcasters to very easily conceal the fact that they are doing it, it can take their schemes and shenanigans to a whole other level. If you do enjoy this style of play and you like to make it easy for player characters to conceal the fact that you're casting spells, you might want to have them make sleight of hand or deception checks to try to hide the fact that they are casting a spell, as opposed to the player just saying, I'm trying to do this in a sneaky way. Put a skill check on it and then let the enemies and the other creatures around be able to make perception checks to detect that it is happening. Doing this means that the players still have a chance to conceal their spell casting, but it makes abilities like subtle spell still really, really valuable.
Now, as we said in the beginning, a lot of these spells are easily misconstrued. And if you have been getting them wrong, don't worry. I can guarantee that Monty and I have been getting these wrong at our table from time to time as well. There are some of these that we actually, through our research, have learned, oh, I need to pay more attention to the way that that's written. And really, when we look at the rules, especially for spells, we should take what it says in the box, no more and no less. Don't start adding in vocabulary into the way a spell is described, and don't take away from the key words that are in there. If you are having trouble with this, try reading the spell description out loud. What stands out to you is what you are able to do and what you are not able to do, and that should be a good guideline to help you on your way with understanding the nuances and complexities of spells and spellcasting in Dungeons & Dragons.
Spells are a wonderful way for player characters to make it feel like they are breaking the rules. They are exceptions to the normal way things work in the game, and that's part of what makes them so magical. It's a little bit easy to make mistakes and go overboard when we're being generous with how we interpret our spells and get things wrong from time to time. The biggest thing that we want to make sure of when we are interpreting spells at our table, particularly when players get creative or tricky with it, is what kind of precedent are you setting for future rules? Is the ruling you make today going to cause a problem in the future? If so, you might want to think about that carefully and always be open in your groups to making sure that you revise and discuss the rules for how spells are working. If you've misinterpreted a spell and it's causing a problem at your table, it's okay to have a discussion about that and say, hey, let's put a stop to this because things are starting to get a little bit overboard with how we're using this spell. And that way your game will stay healthy and fun and involved for everybody involved.
So this has been a look at 10 commonly mistaken spells in Dungeons & Dragons 5th Edition. Tell us about some of your spell misconceptions that you've learned along the way in the comments below.
The videos that we create on our channel are made possible thanks to the generosity and support of our Patreon community. If you're enjoying our show, please consider supporting us on Patreon. You can find it by following the links in the description below or at patreon.com/dungeon_dudes.
Don't forget to check out our live play in the Worlds of Drakenheim, which airs Tuesday nights at 6 p.m. Eastern at twitch.tv/dungeon_dudes. You can find all the previous episodes right up over here.
And we have plenty more videos to help you out with the rules for spells and spellcasting in D&D 5e right up over here.
Please subscribe to our channel so that you never miss an episode.
Thank you so much for watching, and we will see you next time in the dungeon.